Assalamu alaikum. Today we shall discuss tuberculous uveitis. But a better terminology would be presumed tuberculous uveitis. Why we call it presumed? We call it presumed because we don't have, in most of the patients, a biopsy or culture from the eye to tell us this is inflammation caused by mycobacterium tuberculosis. So we rely on clinical findings, as we shall discuss, on tuberculin skin test, history of contact, response to antituberculous treatment. In fact, we have a special interest in tuberculous uveitis. When I diagnose a case of tuberculous uveitis, I'm happy because I know that we give the patient the treatment and he's cured. You don't need to give the patient long-term immunosuppressive therapy. So the lecture that I'm going to give today is based on several review articles that we wrote in the literature about tuberculous uveitis. For those who are interested, they can get these papers from our secretary. We know that tuberculosis is re-emerging as a global health problem. We know that the number of infected patients with tuberculosis is increasing. And if you look at the frequency, this is from one of our articles. In this article, we looked at the frequency of tuberculous uveitis in reported series from different countries. Then you can see that in a study from Saudi Arabia, this is our paper, it was 17.8% frequency among a large series of patients with uveitis. Another paper from Saudi Arabia, this is also from our institute, 26%, but these were cases that are admitted to treat uveitis. From India, 5.6%, and from India, another study, 10%. From Japan, about 7%. From another study from Saudi Arabia, from another institute, 10%. And from Italy, 7%. From Congo, they're talking about 6%. So you see that there are a lot of variation, but these variations are related to the epidemiology of uveitis in different countries, and also the level of awareness about the diagnosis of TB. I always tell that we have to keep the diagnosis of TB in the back of our mind and to rule it in patients, especially with chronic uveitis and patients who are not responding or are showing recurrence to immunosuppressive therapy. So as I said, in a series of 642 patients at King Abdul University Hospital that were reviewed by Dr. Dahri Hoda, she was resident with us from Emirates, and the most common diagnosis or specific diagnostic entity was Vogt-Koenig-Harada disease, followed by tuberculosis, followed by Behçet disease and toxoplasmosis. Tuberculosis is common in our region. And this is a paper that was published a few years ago. We have to know that intraocular tuberculosis is a great mimicker of various uveitis entities. A high index of clinical suspicion is essential for early diagnosis, so you have to look for it. Diagnosis should be considered when an explained chronic uveitis with the characteristic clinical signs, I'm going to discuss in full detail the characteristic clinical signs of ocular TB, that occur and promptly requires upon treating with corticosteroid or immunosuppressive therapy. This is very crucial evidence that if you have an infectious uveitis, you give immunosuppressive therapy alone, what will happen? Inflammation will deteriorate. If you have toxo and you give the patient steroids, then you will induce fulminating inflammation. The same for TB. Patients with TB treated only with steroids, many studies showed this, they never respond and they tend to recur and even the inflammation becomes more severe. You have to keep in mind that most of the patients with tuberculous uveitis, they have no history of pulmonary or other systemic forms. before we consider ocular TB as a subtype of extrapulmonary TB. You don't need, this is a fight that we had with the medical group and we convinced them at last, you don't need evidence of pulmonary involvement to diagnose ocular TB. Why is that? This is an important statement from an old paper that showed that the absence of clinically evident pulmonary TB does not rule out ocular TB, as about 60% of patients with extrapulmonary TB has no evidence of pulmonary TB. You can have TB of the spine or of the brain, but without pulmonary TB. You don't need pulmonary TB to make a diagnosis of extrapulmonary tuberculosis or to make a diagnosis of ocular tuberculosis. So the diagnostic criteria that we and the many others, you can see the huge number of that in most of the studies are using to diagnose presumed to be uveitis are ocular findings consistent with possible tuberculosis, with no other causes of uveitis suggested by history, symptoms, or ancillary testing. So that's why you should be very familiar with the pattern of ocular manifestation of TB, and I'm going to do a lot of effort today to show you the different presentation. Now, if you have a patient with Voigt-Koenig-Rada disease, so the patient had a specific uveitic entity, so this is not TB, but he might have positive tuberculin skin test. If I have a patient with typical Behçet disease, so the clinical findings are indicating Behçet disease, even if the patient has BBD skin test positive, tuberculin skin test positive. You can have a patient with toxoplasmosis, CMV, uveitis, and so on. So you have to rule out clinical findings suggestive of other uveitic entities. So you need ocular findings consistent with possible tuberculosis with no other causes of uveitis suggested by history, symptoms, or ancillary testing. Is that clear? Second, strongly positive tuberculin skin test results. We use a cutoff level of 15 millimeter area of induration of necrosis. You have to measure induration, not hyperemia. I had a lot of discussion with the residents by the way they are testing the induration. So you have to measure induration rather than hyperemia. And then, which is the most important, you give the patient anti-tuberculous treatment. If the patient responds with no recurrence after completing the course of anti-B treatment, you know for sure this is tuberculosis. So the response to anti-tuberculous therapy with absence of recurrence is very important. So these are the three criteria that we and others rely on. How about tuberculin skin testing? I would like to clarify a few points. It is of great importance to provide supportive information when clinical signs or symptoms suggest TB. But you should consider the size of the reaction. The larger the size of the reaction, the more it will be specific for tuberculosis. And contact history. We always ask the patient if he has contact with the patient with tuberculosis, or if there is a family history of tuberculosis, because this will increase the possibility that the inflammation in the eye is related to tuberculosis. A very common mistake, even I had to fix in international meetings, that some they say, okay, if the patient had positive BBD, this might be due to BCG vaccination. Then everyone should know that the effect of BCG vaccination on tuberculin skin test declines over the first 7 years of life. So after the age of 7, never consider BCG as a cause of the positive tuberculin skin test. Is that clear? Second, an induration which is more than 14 millimeter is unlikely to be due to prior BCG vaccination. So strongly positive test is impossible to be due to BCG vaccination. And I think I managed to correct this wrong impression in all the international meetings that I attended, because frequently we have people from infectious disease speciality that always agree with me that BCG vaccination should not be considered after the age of 7, and also when it is strongly positive, it is very unlikely to be due to BCG vaccination. Now, when we wrote the paper with Dr. Dahri, we looked specifically at tuberculin skin testing, because any patient with uveitis, before we start to, on treatment, we do in our hospital tuberculin skin test for several reasons, to help in diagnosing TB, and also we know that the patient had Behçet disease, but before we start infliximab, for example, we should do tuberculin skin test. Why? Because infliximab can induce tuberculosis in a patient with latent tuberculosis. So any patient before starting immunosuppressive therapy should have tuberculin skin test, even if we know that this is not TB of the eye, even if we know that this is VKH. Because if the patient, we know that patient is VKH, before we start immunosuppressive therapy, we have to do tuberculin skin test, and if it is positive, we should give the patient prophylactic and tuberculous treatment. Otherwise, we can induce tuberculosis. Is that clear? So all patients in our institute before on admission, we do tuberculin skin test for them. And then we looked at the frequency of having positive tuberculin skin test in patients with a specific uveitic entity. Meaning, we know that this is Behçet, this is VKH, toxo. What is the frequency of having positive tuberculin skin test in patients with a specific uveitic entity? So the tuberculin skin test in all patients, we had in this study 114 patients with presumed tuberculous uveitis. Of course, all these patients had a strong positive tuberculin skin test. And the mean area of induration was 24 millimeters. All these patients that we know that they are having tuberculous uveitis, they had therapeutic response to anti-tuberculous treatment. So we know that these patients have tuberculous uveitis. Then when we compared this with the remaining patient, 728 patients that we know that they have specific uveitic entities like HLB27, like Behçet, like toxo, and so on, only 2.3% had positive BBD. Only 2.3%. So what does this mean? The conclusion that we wrote in this paper is that the presence of a strong positive test, tuberculin skin test, with no other specific cause of uveitis should raise the suspicion of a tuberculous etiology. So if you have a patient with uveitis, he has no evidence of other specific uveitic entity, and the tuberculin skin test strong positive, you have to consider tuberculosis. And this is in agreement with other publication, like this paper published in 2013, that emphasize the importance of tuberculin skin test as an indirect evidence of presumed tuberculous uveitis. Another test to help you diagnosing tuberculous uveitis is interferon gamma release assays. So what are interferon gamma release assays? You take the peripheral blood mononuclear cells from the patient, incubate it with two specific antigens for mycobacterium tuberculosis. We know that if the patient is exposed to mycobacterium, the incubation of his blood, peripheral blood mononuclear cells with the mycobacterium tuberculosis antigens will induce the peripheral blood mononuclear cells to produce interferon gamma. And then you can measure the level of interferon gamma. When this test started, and my colleagues, particularly in Europe, were very happy, said, oh, this will give us a better diagnostic way to diagnose tuberculosis of the eye. But later on, many studies suggested that there is no advantage of QuantiFERON, this QuantiFERON TB gold assay, over tuberculin skin test for the diagnosis of active or latent tuberculosis. So we still believe that, and many of my colleagues, they believe that tuberculin skin test should be more important than interferon gamma release assay to make a diagnosis of tuberculous uveitis. Again, this is a paper from our colleagues in Singapore. They showed that the QuantiFERON TB gold in tube is not superior to tuberculin skin test and sensitivity in patients with presumed tuberculous uveitis. You need the patient to evaluate the patient. You need to do chest imaging. We prefer CT chest rather than X-ray. And our Indian colleagues were talking a lot about PCR. However, it is not very reliable, and sensitivity is very low. Imaging that we use to diagnose, to help diagnose the disease, fluorescein, ICG today, we in the CTR, we talked about the ICG, OCT for macular edema, ultrasonography, and microperimetry. So what are the clinical features that you expect to see in a patient with tuberculous uveitis? Acute anterior uveitis can be seen, chronic granulomatous anterior uveitis, intermediate uveitis, vitritis, macular edema, retinal vasculitis with a specific type of retinal vasculitis that I'm going to discuss now, neuroretinitis, choroidal tubercles, multifocal choroiditis, serpiginous-like choroiditis, subretinal abscess, endophthalmitis, and bannophthalmitis. So retinal vasculitis in tuberculosis is very peculiar. It tends to be obliterated briefly bites. It tends to destroy the retinal circulation to cause severe retinal ischemia. I'm going to show example. So in this paper that we recently published, in fact, the files of the patient were reviewed by Dr. Awad Elgarni, and the paper published early this year, we presented the spectrum of clinical manifestations of tuberculous uveitis in Saudi Arabia. So when we looked at our data, we had 91 patients, 141 eyes. At that time, when he reviewed the files, we had 91 patients. The uveitis was bilateral in 56% of the patients. 52 were females, 47% were males, and the mean age was 48 years. Contact with active pulmonary tuberculosis was detected in 17.6% of patients. So always you have to ask for a history of contact or family history of tuberculosis. Diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis was noted in 2.2% of the patients. Two patients use antituberculous treatment. But what is here interesting, the duration of symptoms, the mean duration of symptoms was about 7 months. What does this mean? These patients usually have long history, and these patients usually receive treatment everywhere based mainly on immunosuppressive therapy, because the treating ophthalmologists are not aware of the diagnosis of TB. So there is always a long interval between the onset of symptoms and results. This is, has been also reported by our colleagues from Italy. There is always a long duration between onset of the disease and presentation to us and making the right diagnosis. So anterior uveitis, as you know, we classify uveitis based on anatomic classification, anterior intermediate posterior uveitis. So anterior uveitis was present in 7% of the eyes, intermediate 13%, posterior uveitis 24%, but the majority are bannuveitis. So 56% of the patients present with bannuveitis. All the patients had a strong positive tuberculin skin test, and the mean area of induration was 24 millimeter. And this is an example of strong positive tuberculin. Strong positive tuberculosis skin test was necrosis. When you see this picture, this is definitely highly suggestive for tuberculosis, another case. Now, if we classified the symptoms or the signs that we saw in the patients, anterior segment manifestations, so mutton fat cratic precipitates were seen in 35% of the eyes, hypopion in 6%, iris nodules 8%, Bisuscinicia in 20%, rubiosus irides in 3.5%, cataract 30%, and pseudophakia in 7%. I'm going to show you many examples so you will not miss a case of TB in the emergency room. So this is a case of, you can see the mutton fat cratic precipitates. Is that clear? And what is this? when you have keratitis with infiltration of blood vessels in the colon, they call it interstitial keratitis. So this is, can be seen frequently in patients with tuberculous uveitis. Now, we could see also in some patients scleral nodule, and you can see hematum fat KPs, bisous syniki are common, and this is after receiving anti-tuberculous treatment. So the scleral nodule disappears. Another case, hematum fat KPs, granulomatous uveitis, large granulomas in the angle, and the patient had inflamed optic nerve, and you can see large granuloma in the angle. Bisous syniki, hematum fat KPs, large multiple granulomas angle. I remember this patient, 16 year old, many members of the family had pulmonary tuberculosis. The vitritis is seen in about 6% and the snowballs in 27%. I'm going to discuss what is peculiar about the snowballs in TB. The snowballs in TB are always large. I consider this one of the important diagnostic features for tuberculous uveitis when I see such very large snowballs, and they're frequently associated with retinal scars, co-retinal scars. Co-retinal scars are one of the important features of ocular TB. So as you can see in this patient, the snowballs and the co-retinal scars. And most of this patient with intermediate uveitis, they have cystoid macular edema and inflamed optic nerve. This is another patient, you can see how big are these snowballs, which are highly suggestive for tuberculous uveitis. Again, this is another the same patient with severe cystoid edema. And what is surprising here, that this cystoid edema responds very quickly to anti-TB treatment and a short course of systemic corticosteroids. Again, this is another patient, you see how big is this snowballs, and again, the typical cystoid macular edema and inflammation of the optic nerve. Retina, retinal vasculitis, these are the signs that you expect to see in a patient with ocular tuberculosis. Retinal vasculitis is seen in 20% of the cases. Neovascularization in 10%, but neovascularization will complicate occlusive retinal vasculitis. Traction retinal detachment, this is the end stage of occlusive retinal vasculitis in 3.5% of the eyes. Optic disc hyperemia in 17%. So I'm going to show you the pattern of retinal vasculitis. This is, it is usually periphlebitis, means that the veins are affected. And as you can see here, you see the perivascular sheathing. It is perivenous sheathing. So the better terminology will be periphlebitis, because the wall of the blood vessels itself are not affected. It is perivascular accumulation of inflammatory cells. And frequently we have hemorrhages because of the leak. Now, this is another patient. I remember when I saw this patient in the emergency room, the resident make a diagnosis of supratumbral branch retinal vein occlusion. But here, the patient had, if he has looked carefully to the vascular sheathing, this is a case of vasculitis with intraretinal hemorrhages. And this is another patient. You see the sick perivenous exudate, intraretinal and periretinal hemorrhage because of the retinal ischemia. This is another example. You can see here the perivascular sheathing, perivenous sheathing, and then fluorescein angiography will tell us this is an ischemic type of retinal vasculitis. This is another patient. Look at the perivenous sheathing, and then look at the angiogram. So the vasculitis in TB tends to be occlusive and tend to destroy the retinal circulation. And as a result of ischemia, you can have neovascularization, recurrent vitreous hemorrhage, traction retinal detachment, and functional loss of the eye if you don't treat the patient properly with anti-TB treatment and laser foot coagulation. So this is another case, and you can see the neovascularization complicating retinal ischemia. And you can see the large areas of retinal ischemia caused by the occlusive vasculitis and tuberculosis. There's another patient who presented already with pre-retinal hemorrhage and the new vessels on the optic nerve, and still look at the very sick perivenous sheathing. Another patient presenting with a large patch of pre-retinal hemorrhage. Patient can present with rubiosis, Why? What is the cause of this rebiosis? Again, occlusive vasculitis causing retinal ischemia, and the patient, this eye was functionally lost. Traction detachment is again because of the vasoproliferative disease as a result of occlusive retinal vasculitis. Now, choroid. Choroid is affected very frequently, and multifocal choroiditis was diagnosed in 10% of the eyes. Solitary granuloma that simulates a tumor. We have seen cases that the patient, even the ultrasound technician, they thought about tumor. But you have to rule out the possibility of choroidal granuloma caused by tuberculosis in 2% of the eyes, and serpiginous-like choroiditis, 2% of the eyes. Nowadays, there is a belief that, as I said this morning, serpiginous-like choroiditis, you have to rule out tuberculosis because majority of these patients are of tuberculosis etiology. This is a case that I presented today in the CTR. This is a young patient, right eye is normal, patient who is referred because of these lesions. And you can see this is a serpiginous type of choroiditis. And serpiginous-like. Why serpiginous-like? Because you can see the lesions are multiple and they extend outside the arcade. The typical immune-mediated serpiginous choroiditis remains around the optic nerve head. But as you can see, this is spreading outside the arcades. The patient was diagnosed to have TB and given a full anti-TB treatment with good response. So this is the fluorescein of the patient. But what is interesting here is ICG. The ICG is showing complete destruction of the choriocapillaris. All these hypofluorescent patches are due to non-filling of the choriocapillaris. The patient was treated with anti-tuberculous treatment, and we could save his eye, and he ended with 20/30 vision. So this is another patient of multifocal choroiditis. You can see the multiple patches in both eyes. ICG always show hypofluorescence of the lesions. Another example, I'm showing you many examples, so again, we don't miss such a case. This is another case of multifocal choroiditis. Another case, you can see the creamy lesions under the retina, and this is a very good case for multifocal choroiditis. This is the other eye, and then if you look at the ICG, all these lesions remain hypofluorescence up to the late phases of the study. Another case, I still remember this young lady with a strong family history of tuberculosis. She had multiple patches of choroiditis. It's a blinding disease because if you don't treat it with anti-B treatment, the lesions will destroy the fovea. I have seen many patients like this. They came with only light perception because they did not receive. One of these patients came from Jeddah. He was treated only with Imuran. I think I have this case in this lecture. And he lost one eye because of he did not receive proper treatment. And this is another case. You can see the aggressive nature of the choroiditis in this patient, but all of them, they behave the same. So this patient was a young patient. He received only immunosuppressive therapy. Look what happened to he lost his left eye. The right eye, we could manage it with anti-tuberculous treatment, and he maintained 20/30 vision in his right eye. This is a patient also was referred to me by a neuro-ophthalmologist. He thought about optic neuritis because the disc is inflamed. But he missed this. What is this? He missed the multifocal choroiditis. The patient had TB. Another example of multifocal choroiditis. So this is a patient at presentation. You can see the mutton fat kibis. Clear? And what are these? Iris nodules. So the patient had granulomatous anterior uveitis. In addition, he had multifocal choroiditis. So this is another patient. Patient can present with, I showed you one case this morning, similar to this case, severe optic nerve head inflammation in addition to multifocal choroiditis. And you can see the ICG is showing nicely the granulomas. Most of these granulomas, you could not see it with fluorescein. You could not see it clinically. But the ICG, as I said, is the best modality to visualize the choroid. It allows you to see the granulomas. This is a patient that I presented this morning. This is a serpiginous-like choroiditis, very aggressive disease. And you can see the choroiditis around the optic nerve. And the patient responded nicely to antituberculous treatment. So this is a case that what we call a solitary granuloma. Keep in mind that you can have such solitary granuloma, which can mimic tumor, in a completely quiet eye. That's why some of these patients are missed. The eye can be completely quiet in the presence of these granulomas. And typically, on ICG, they remain hypofluorescent. This is another patient with a large solitary granuloma. These patients are referred as intraocular tumors. And the eye is completely quiet. The ICG typically will show hypofluorescence corresponding to this mass. Another case of solitary granuloma. I'll show you the effect of treatment later when I talk about treatment in these patients. And the ICG typically will show hypofluorescence. This is after treatment. Now, this is the patient that unfortunately was treated only with Imuran. He came from Jeddah. His right eye localized the area of choroiditis, but look here. This eye completely lost. And this is how it looked after anti-B therapy. You cannot save anything, but at least you save the eye from being inoculated. So you see a huge scar involving the macula. So again, this is another example of serpiginous-like choroiditis. As I said, whenever you see a case of serpiginous-like choroiditis, you have to consider tuberculous etiology. Another case of serpiginous-like choroiditis, and you can see here the lesions are spreading outside the arcades. So macular edema is a common complication in ocular TB. 33% of the eyes had macular edema. In patients with intermediate uveitis, like picture, 61% had macular edema. In posterior uveitis, 26% macular edema. Benign uveitis, 34% macular edema. But the good news here is that if you treat this patient properly with anti-TB treatment and a short course of semicorticosteroids, you can control this edema. And this is one of these examples of macular edema in a patient with tuberculous uveitis. So this is another case. Look at the matum fat kipis, posterior synechia, and this is a posterior segment, macular edema, severe cystoid macular edema in this patient. And on ICG, although we did not see the granulomas, but the ICG allowed us to see many granulomas. Granulomas are usually rounded or oval hypofluorescent patches. So the treatment of presumed tuberculous uveitis, we need anti-tuberculous treatment for 9 months, and we always combine this with a short course of systemic corticosteroids. Many studies, if you look at the literature, showed that patients who were treated only with systemic corticosteroid continued to have recurrences or showed worsening of inflammation, and the inflammation was controlled only with anti-TB treatment. We usually start by with four drugs: isoniazid, ethambutol, pyrazinamide, rifampicin for 2 months. And then we'll stop ethambutol and pyrazinamide and continue with INH and rifampicin for another 7 months. Systemic prednisone, we started with 1 milligram per kg body weight and tapered and discontinued after control of the inflammation. The mean duration of using systemic corticosteroids is only 4 months. Then I'll talk about how we should manage occlusive retinal vasculitis. The management of occlusive retinal vasculitis was based on these publications that we published in year 2000. For many years, I have interest. This is 2002. I have a special interest in tuberculosis. And in this paper that we published in British Journal of Ophthalmology, we explained to the ophthalmologists how should we manage a case of occlusive retinal vasculitis due to tuberculosis step by step, depending on the clinical finding. So if a patient presents to you with retinal vasculitis, I showed you some examples, but no ischemia, only inflammation, then you need to treat the patient with anti-tuberculous therapy plus systemic corticosteroids to control active vasculitis. If the patient presents with active vasculitis with ischemia, so in addition to medical treatment, steroids and anti-B, you need to add a scatter laser to the areas of retinal ischemia to control the ischemic component of the disease, to control the neovascularization, to prevent vitreous hemorrhage traction detachment. Unfortunately, if the patient presents with hemorrhage, and we have good number of these patients, then you need to do early vitrectomy. Don't wait. Because if you wait for a long time, you will give a chance for the fibrovascular tissue to be strongly adherent to the retina. And it is usually in the mid-periphery. And it is almost impossible to dissect it from the retina. So the three lessons here. Active vasculitis, without ischemia, you need medical treatment. Active vasculitis with ischemia, in addition to medical treatment, you need to add a scatter laser to the ischemic retina. If the patient bleeds, you need to do early vitrectomy. So in our study, the interval between discontinuation of treatment and last follow-up ranged from 12 to 144 months. So we were looking specifically in our paper how many of the patients flared up after completing a course of anti-B treatment. So we have almost 100 patients. And these patients were followed for a longer time, even after completion of the treatment. So the follow-up after stopping the treatment ranged between 12 to 144 months. This is a very long follow-up. Only 2 patients recurred 4 and 10 months after discontinuation of the treatment. And then we had to start another course of anti-TB, and both responded to another course of anti-tuberculous treatment and systemic corticosteroids. And follow-up was 1 and 4 years. So this information is very important because it tells us that these patients were treated correctly, that this patient, because he did not recur after we stopped the treatment, it means that the inflammation was due to tuberculosis. Complications that we saw in these patients, 14% had cataract, glaucoma. Tuberculosis is not a common cause for glaucoma in about 8% of the eyes, hypotony in 3% of the eye, and the choroidal neovascular membrane in 3% of the eyes. I'm going to show you some examples of the effect of treatment, and this the after treatment were taken after completion of the course of anti-B treatment. So this is at presentation, you see granulomatous inflammation with multiple fat kidneys, and this is after the treatment. Another case, you can see the large granuloma in the angle and after treatment. Another case, completely quiet eye after treatment. And this is, again, I told you, cystoid macular edema is seen in about 33% of the eyes, and it responds very nicely to anti-B treatment and systemic corticosteroids, and this is after treatment. And the visual outcome is not bad. This is another case of edema after treatment. And this is the case with multifocal choroiditis, and then after treatment, the patient had counting finger vision. After treatment, we could control the choroiditis. Of course, this choroiditis leaves very bad scar, and this is typical for tuberculous choroiditis. It ends with a very aggressive scar, but the patient, because the fovea was not involved, patient ended with 20/30 vision. And this is the patient that had circumpapillary, serpiginous-like choroiditis, as you can see here. And after treatment, we could control the choroiditis, but we have a large scar, but is not involving the fovea. That's why the vision is good. This is a patient that had tumor-like granuloma, solitary granuloma, and this is after treatment. So this is peripheral ischemia. As you can see, the new visit. This is as a result of occlusive vasculitis. You see fluorescein angiography, severe peripheral ischemia with the new vessels. And this is the pattern of lasers that you need to apply. You apply a scatter laser only in the ischemic retina. You don't need to do full band retina foot coagulation. You only need to treat the ischemic retina. And this is a patient at presentation with vitreous hemorrhage and after receiving band retinal foot coagulation. And I still remember this patient. The patient had very aggressive vasculitis, severe macular edema. You can see severe retinal ischemia, very large new vessels. So all these are complications of retinal ischemia. And the patient with a combination of anti-TB treatment, systemic corticosteroid, and good laser foot coagulation, as you can see here, we could control the inflammation. We could control also macular edema. So this is the example of patients that needed medical management as well as scatter laser to control retinal ischemia. So this is a patient who presented with end-stage disease for aggressive fibrovascular proliferation, traction retinal detachment, vitreous hemorrhage. And this is after vitrectomy. As I said, if the patient bleed, if the patient had traction, you should operate these patients early. So this is a case after vitrectomy and full band retinal foot coagulation. And this is a very aggressive traction retinal detachment before and after vitrectomy. So we looked at the visual outcome, and a good vision, 20/40 or better, was achieved in about 60% of the eyes. It's not very high outcome, but this is mainly related to the fact that the delayed presentation to us. Only 60% of the patients had good vision, 20/40 or better. And but when we compared initial vision with last vision and last follow-up, there was significant improvement in vision. Even the macular edema, when we compared the macular thickness before treatment, that was the mean was 438 microns, and after treatment, it was reduced to 217 microns. So the macular edema improved. So in conclusion, in recent years, ocular involvement due to tuberculosis has reemerged. Tuberculous uveitis is a treatable disease. I said in the introduction of this lecture, when I diagnose a case as tuberculous uveitis, I'm happy, because I know that I'm going to cure the disease with anti-TB treatment, and the patient will not need long-term immunosuppressive therapy. A high index of suspicion of the diagnosis should be maintained in patients with unexplained chronic uveitis, especially uveitis that becomes worse with immunosuppressive therapy. Treatment with anti-TB therapy combined with systemic corticosteroid induces resolution of inflammation with no recurrences, as we showed, after stopping anti-TB treatment and systemic corticosteroid. Because if this was an immune-mediated uveitis, once you stop steroids, what would happen? It will flare up again. Treatment with anti-TB therapy combined with systemic corticosteroid induces a significant improvement in visual acuity, reduction of macular edema. And I did not include this data, but we showed that we can also improve the central retinal sensitivity and fixation characteristics using microperimetry. Thank you very much for your attention. We have time for like two questions. Hamid.
inflammation of, of
our
the
Indian
eye.
Colleagues, they talk about Herxheimer reaction.
Yeah.
Herxheimer reaction, we never saw this. They talk about Vishal Gupta, she was here, and Amod Gupta. They are reporting that some patients with serbiginous like choroiditis, when they treated them with anti-TB treatment, the patient showed worsening. They call it Herxheimer. I think Herxheimer is described for syphilis, right? Yeah. We never saw this. And perhaps I attribute this because we always add to anti-TB treatment systemic corticosteroids.
Prof, when you have a case that you need to use rituximab, which is anti-CD20, you know, it's not that involved in TB or in the activation of TB. Do you use it concurrent rituximab with anti-TB, or you prefer?
Why should I? You are talking about if I'm treating a case, yes, of tuberculosis.
No, not a tuberculosis.
No. You mean a patient that needed rituximab therapy?
Yes,
and his BBD positive. Was positive. But he was receiving rituximab, for example, we use it only for VKH.
Yes.
For VKH. Any immunosuppressive therapy, because a patient with VKH, before I give him rituximab, he's already on steroids and CellCept. So if the patient was positive for BBD, tuberculin skin test, we should have given him prophylactic treatment.
But will you stop the immune modulators until you complete the course of anti-TB, or you will use it at the same time?
No, we don't stop, for example, CellCept completely. We taper it, but we keep it. This is to improve the efficacy of rituximab. But again, any immunosuppressive therapy, and you cannot give immunosuppressive therapy in a patient with tuberculin skin positive unless you cover the patient with at least INH. Okay, shukran.